Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Shalom. Thank you for watching this video. I'm taking a moment to share some important information about Congregation Shema Yisrael. We are following the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, to purchase a new facility for our congregation in the heart of the Jewish community of Rochester, New York. We've experienced several miraculous confirmations that this purchase is God's plan to make us more effective in our outreach to the Jewish community here. Our previous facility has been sold, and we are meeting in rented quarters until we close on the new facility at the end of 2020. Through the generous donations of our regular attenders, we've raised a significant part of the funds that will be needed to close, but we also need your help. If you've been blessed by our videos, please pray for us and ask the Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for Congregation Shema Yisrael? If you pray this prayer and do what God leads you to do in faith, we will succeed in purchasing this facility and become much more effective in reaching the Jewish people of Rochester with the life-saving good news of Messiah Yeshua. To participate, please visit shematime.org, that's shematime.org, where you can learn more about this amazing move of God and where you can support us by clicking the donate button. Thank you, and may the Lord richly bless you as you watch this video. So here's a little bit of humor for those of you who are familiar with Jewish customs. The question is COVID-19 part of a Jewish holiday? The problem is, it's hard to tell which one. See, we're remembering what things used to be like last year as if it's Rosh Hashanah. We're only allowed to eat together outside, like it's Sukkot. We're playing games with children and each other like it's Hanukkah. We're wearing masks like it's Purim. Everyone is walking around with cleaning wipes like it's Passover. We're staying up all night like it's Shavuot. We're eating our meals with our families and sleeping late like it's Shabbat. So what holiday is this? And when does it end? Because I'm ready to make Hadalah. That's the traditional ending ceremony at the end of Shabbat now. I want to thank our old friend Ira Goldberg for that one. Those of you who remember Ira. And I also want to thank Ethel for her choice of songs. I don't think she knew what we were going to do today, but she chose for the offering song, By the Blood. Did you know what we're going to do today? We're going to come to the Lord's table? Yeah, that's amazing. You did that last week also. And Mark, also, thank you for that awesome time of prayer. So, going to talk about the Jewish roots today of the Lord's Supper. And just to get you a little bit of Hebrew, in Hebrew that's Sudat Adonai. You all know the word Adonai, that's the Lord. Sudat is the Supper. So I'm sure all of you who are here and all of you who are watching are familiar with what's called the Last Supper, right? At that meal with his disciples, Yeshua gave us the new covenant. Now, you may not be aware of that, and if you're not, I would like to encourage you to go get your Bible, not right now, but later, and read through John chapter 13 through 17, all of which took place at the Last Supper. And we understand that the back of this book, the back part of this book, or called the New Testament sometimes, is actually called the New Covenant. But the actual covenant, the New Covenant, the agreement between God and human beings is in that passage from John 13 through John 17. So if you're familiar with it, you'll recognize that in that passage are the covenant conditions. Obey my commands, love one another, abide in the vine, be in unity, right? And the covenant promises. eternal life, a place in heaven, Yeshua dwelling in you in the form of the Holy Spirit, forgiveness, and two new covenant ceremonies, the washing of feet, and also what we're going to talk about today, the Sudat Adonai, the Lord's Supper, also called communion or Eucharist. The Lord's Supper is the new covenant's renewal meal. And the Holy Spirit led me today to talk about the Jewish roots of the Lord's Supper and to arrange for all of us who are here to come to his table. And so one more time, for those of you who are watching on the live stream, at some point, go get some crackers and some grape juice. And only those of you who have entered into the new covenant should do this. But hopefully you've already gone to your kitchen so you won't miss what I'm saying, or you could just turn the sound on or take your phone with you into the kitchen and get what you need. Okay, so if you have not entered into the new covenant or you're not sure, you should not participate in this, and we'll get to that later, because if you have a desire to enter in to the new covenant for the first time, you can pray with me to enter in just before we come to the Lord's table, and you can participate in that as your first act of being part of the new covenant. Okay, so we're going to look at Luke chapter 22 and verse 19, and let's see if we got it up there. Yep, okay. So this is what Yeshua instructed us. Also taking a piece of matzah or unleavened bread, he made the barucha, the blessing, broke it, gave it to them, them being his disciples, and said, "This is my body, which is being given for you. Do this in memory of me." And then verse 20, he did the same with the cup after the meal, saying, "This cup is the new covenant ratified by my blood, which is being poured out for you." Now, I hope you can appreciate that the statements that he just made are radical. The matzah is my body. The cup is my blood. Do this in memory of me. And I was going through this, was remembering as a new believer, we started attending a Dutch Reformed church, because that's where the people who led us to the Lord worshiped. And I remember my first experience of the Lord's Supper in the church. And it just seemed so un-Jewish to me. I didn't see any connection to Judaism, didn't see any connection to what I'd experienced in the synagogue. But as I studied, I came to understand that Jewish connection, which gave me a tremendous more depth of meaning for what this is. So I believe it's important for all of us to understand that Yeshua was not creating something new when he did this. He wasn't creating something novel that was unconnected to the Tanakh, to the Old Testament, or to the culture that he lived in. To his biblically literate Jewish disciples, what he did made many connections to the things that were already part of their lives. And these connections gave his words and actions deep spiritual meaning to them. So that's what I call the Jewish roots of the Messianic faith, those connections. And when you grasp those roots, and I know many of you have grasped many of the roots, what do? They give you a much sense of a much deeper meaning of these things, right? How many agree with it, right? Right. So if you've participated in our community Passover Seder, which we've held for many, many years until like last year with the virus, or any other Messianic Passover Seder, you have learned how the Jewish roots of the Lord's Supper, the Sudat Adonai, in the Last Supper, grow out of a traditional Passover Seder. And for those of you who are not understanding that, the Passover Seder is the covenant renewal meal of the covenant with Moses, or the covenant at Mount Sinai, or the covenant God made with Israel. So we're going to start by looking at those roots. And then we're going to look at six other roots that I saw in the Tanakh. There's probably more. So Luke chapter 22 and verse 15, Yeshua said to them, "I have really wanted so much to celebrate this Seder with you before I die." So that's just to make sure everybody understands the Last Supper was a Passover Seder, right? Okay. And the word Seder is important to understand. It's a Hebrew word, and it means order. So the traditional order of the Seder goes back to before Yeshua's time. And Yeshua followed that order at the Last Supper or the Last Seder. And if you're familiar with the order and you read through John 13 through 17, you'll see it. You'll see all the things that he did were part of the traditional order. And he took two elements of the Seder, the renewal meal of the Mosaic covenant, the wine or juice and the matzah, and he used them in giving us the new covenant. So just to go back to verse 19 of Luke 22, taking a piece of matzah or unleavened bread, he made the bracha, the blessing, broke it, gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which is being given for you. Do this in memory of me." So that matzah is eaten to remember his body given as a sacrifice for each of you. And in the traditional Passover Seder, the matzah is a memorial of the body of the sacrificed Passover lamb. And it is broken by the Seder leader and passed around to everybody participating in the Seder. So in case you don't know what a matzah looks like, we've got one here in the picture on the slide. Can we get that next slide? There's the matzah. And I'm not showing a side view of it, but it's very, very thin because it's unleavened. And leaven in the Bible represents sin, just as Yeshua was without sin. Also, it's traditionally made. This is the way a traditional matzah is made, with the little holes in it, because when you bake it, you need those holes or it'll kind of become a blob. And the holes are put in a pattern. You see what the pattern is? Stripes, right? So the traditional matzah is made with stripes and piercing. And if you use your imagination just a little bit, it always is more dark at some points than other points. So if you're using your imagination, you could say it looks a little bruised. And so we see here that the matzah itself tells the story of the Messiah, which is amazing because the people who make the matzah don't believe in the Messiah. But they make the matzahs this way, and it tells the story that he was pierced by the nails and the crown of thorns. He was bruised by the beating, and he was striped by the whip. So right there, that's a root. That's a big root of the Lord's Supper. The matzah that we eat is representing his body, and it looks like his body if you're using matzah. Verse 20 of Luke 22. He did the same with the cup after the meal, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, ratified by my blood, which is being poured out for you." So every Seder includes the cups of the covenant. They're cups of wine or grape juice, and they're based on Exodus chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. And that passage is actually traditionally called the Passover Covenant, right there. So we're going to go through those verses. Chapter 6, verse 6 of Exodus. The Lord spoke this to Moses to tell the people of Israel when they were very discouraged because Moses had gone to Pharaoh and Pharaoh had said, "No way, I'm not going to let you go." And he had loaded them down with more work, made it more difficult for them. So the Lord spoke to Moses and said, "Therefore say to the people of Israel, I am Adonai, the Lord. I will free you or bring you out from the forced labor of the Egyptians." And I put up there the transliteration of the Hebrew. That word for free you is hotzeiti, and it means to separate you or bring you forth. So the word that we use in English is sanctify. That means to set a person apart for God. So the first cup is called the cup of sanctification. And then verse 6 goes on, "I will rescue you from their oppression." And the word rescue there is not sal or snatch away or rescue or deliver you. And so the second cup is called the cup of deliverance. And then in verse 6 goes on, says, "And I will redeem you." And the word for redeem in Hebrew is ga'al. And it means to buy back or ransom. "And I will redeem you." That's the third cup of the covenant. And understand that what redeem means is that God redeemed our ancestors so they no longer belong to their slave masters. He bought them back. He paid the price so that they would no longer be owned by their slave masters. And then it goes on to say, with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. And I'm not going to go into it, but just to get your imagination going, how did Yeshua redeem us? With his arms outstretched on the cross. But verse 7, I will take you as my people and I will be your God. So make you my people. That's the fourth cup called the cup of the kingdom. You will be my people and I will be your God. So in Luke chapter 22 again, and back to verse 20, it says, he did the same with the cup after the meal, saying, this cup is the new covenant ratified by my blood, which is being poured out for you. So which cup did Yeshua make the cup of the new covenant? Well, all you have to do is look at a traditional Haggadah, which is the order of the Seder. And in the traditional Seder, the cup after the meal is the third cup, the cup of redemption. So here's the root. Yeshua's sacrificial death is represented by his blood. His death redeems you. His death redeems you by paying the penalty for your sin. It purchases you back from being a slave to sin and to Satan. He has no legal right to you anymore, even though you have broken God's commandments. I have broken God's commandments. But because he redeemed us, he paid the penalty, he has no legal right to us anymore. And Yeshua chose that cup to be the cup of the new covenant because it's the most significant in bringing the new covenant. Okay, but what about the Seder? Why did he choose to do all this at a Seder? The Seder was the renewal meal of the Mosaic covenant. He chose it to be the setting of giving us the new covenant. And here's why I believe. Because he wanted to demonstrate that the new covenant was built on the foundation of the Mosaic covenant. And God doesn't break his covenants. So the new covenant didn't negate the Mosaic covenant. It built on it and added to it. Whereas replacement theology has led to the teaching that the Mosaic covenant was annulled or passed away. That contradicts Yeshua's declaration in Matthew 5, verse 17. Don't think that I have come to abolish the Torah or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to complete. And the sense of that word in the Greek of complete is to fill to the fullness, to complete. So, I also believe, and I hope I can convince you, that Yeshua also fulfilled the other three cups of the covenant. The cup of sanctification. He set us apart from this world to God. The cup of deliverance. He set us free from the bondage of sin and from demonic oppression. The cup of the kingdom. He made us God's people. And he made the God of Israel our Lord. Amen. So, I think you'll agree with me. Those are some really awesome roots, are they not? And those are roots of the Sudat Adonai, the Lord's Supper, in the Passover Seder. Now, this week I was reading the Parsha, and as I read, I realized that there are Jewish roots of the Sudat Adonai, and therefore of the New Covenant, that come from other parts of the Tanakh. And so I began to study those, and that's what I want to share with you in the rest of the time I have today. So, start with Matthew 26 and verse 28. Yeshua said, "For this is my blood, which ratifies the new covenant, my blood shed on behalf of many, so that they may have their sins forgiven." So here we see that the covenant between God and his people, the new covenant, was ratified by the, not just the blood, but the sacrifice of Yeshua's life. And I realized that that's the first other Jewish root of the Lord's Supper. And it springs from the sacrifices were always part of biblical covenants. Think of the covenants. The covenant God made with Adam. What happened after that covenant? Animals had to be killed to make the skins for clothing for Adam and Eve. The covenant with Noah. Noah brought clean animals, not just two, but seven clean animals, so that he could make sacrifices, and he made sacrifices when God declared the Noahide covenant to him. The covenant with Abraham. Abraham sacrificed animals, cut them in half, and a furnace or a flame passed between those animals, confirming the covenant. So Yeshua's sacrifice of his life to ratify the new covenant was not a new idea. Its roots were in the animal sacrifices that ratified or sealed all of the former covenants that God's made. Now, you and I, we have an experience having to sacrifice an animal to enter into the new covenant, thank God. But imagine how serious entering into his covenant would be if you had to sacrifice an innocent lamb to become part of the new covenant, to partake of the new covenant. Imagine that. Beautiful, innocent lamb, you have to kill it to pay the penalty so that you can come in. So that would make it very serious, wouldn't it? But how much more serious is it that God sacrificed his only son so that you and I could be partakers of the new covenant? And that's what he did. Luke, again, 22:19 says this, "Also taking a piece of matzah, he made the bracha, broke it, gave it to them, and said, 'This is my body, which is being given for you. Do this in memory of me.'" Now, notice here, he gave the matzah to his disciples to eat with him. And so here's another one of those Jewish roots of the Lord's Supper springing out of the Tanakh. Eating together is part of making a covenant. The first appearance of this is really interesting. I was trying to see where was the first eating together? And what I found was it was the wedding covenant meal between Jacob and Leah in Genesis 29. And of course, it's still with us today. Marriage is a covenant, right? And what do you do after the covenant is sealed by the ceremony? You have a reception. You have a meal. So eating a meal together is part of making a covenant. Jacob and Laban in Genesis 31 sacrificed and ate together, making a covenant. The Passover covenant, eating the lamb that was sacrificed to protect from the plague, was part of what every family had to do to keep the death plague from them. The Sinai covenant in Genesis chapter 24, when they were at Mount Sinai and God called Moses and the 70 elders up on the mountain and they saw the God of Israel, it says, and what did they do? Anybody remember? They ate before the God of Israel. They ate. So we can see Yeshua eating with his disciples was part of him giving the new covenant. It was part of God covenanting with Israel. So eating the elements of the Sudat Adonai, the Lord's Supper, is a significant part of each of us participating in the covenant. And here's the thing that got to me as I studied this. When we do it, we're eating before God, in the presence of God, like the elders of Israel. And it says there, you know, they ate in the presence of God and they didn't die. I mean, that's how much in the presence of God they were. They were afraid they were going to die, but they didn't die. So that's another root. This eating together is a root. The next root springs from what you are eating, the sacrifice. In Leviticus chapter 7 and verse 15, it says, "The meat of the sacrifice of his fellowship offerings for thanksgiving is to be eaten on the day of his offering. He is not to leave any of it until morning." Now, the fellowship offering is Todat Shlamav, which should probably translate it as a peace offering. So this is an offering that they would have made in the times of the temple when things were going well. I have peace. And I'm thanking you, God, that there's peace in my soul, there's peace in my family, there's peace in my town, there's peace in my nation. I'm making an offering, and it's a thank offering for peace to God. But see what it's saying here. The offerer was to eat the offering, not the priest, but the person making the offering was to eat the offering. Now, this is not the case with sin offerings or guilt offerings or trespass offerings, but with a fellowship offering or the peace offering, the offerer was to eat it. So now we see a little bit of more of this eating of the sacrifice which is, I thought was really interesting. Deuteronomy chapter 12 and verse 17. You may not eat it within your gates. I'm sorry. You may not eat within your gates the tithe of your grain or new wine or oil or the firstborn of your herd or of your flock or any of your vow offerings that you vow or your freewill offerings or the offering of your hand. Verse 18. Rather, you are to eat them before Adonai, the Lord your God, in the place Adonai your God chooses. You, your son and daughter, your slave and maid, and the Levite within your gates, and you will rejoice before Adonai your God in every undertaking of your hand. So what is the saying? The tithes on the farm produce that they produce, whether it was vegetable or animal, were to be eaten before the Lord in his presence, which in those days was at the temple or before that at the tabernacle. And they were to be eaten with rejoicing, a feast, a celebration with your family and your servants and your Levites who live near you. Why? Because when God makes a covenant with you, it should be a cause for rejoicing, right? And it's a family thing with your family, God's family eating together and the families eating together. In Deuteronomy chapter 14, then, it gets even more interesting. This is a passage referring to the tithes on produce and livestock and saying they were to be eaten by the people offering them, but only at the temple. And then it's beginning to talk about, well, what if you're a long ways from the temple? Your farm is a long ways from the temple. So in 14:25, it says this. Then you are to exchange the tithe for silver. Bind up the silver in your hand and go to the place that Adonai your God chooses. That's the temple. Verse 26. This is the thing that really surprised me. You may spend the money for whatever your soul desires. Cattle, sheep, wine, strong drink, or whatever your soul asks of you. Then you will eat there before Adonai your God and rejoice, you and your household. So what this is saying is if you live too far away to transport your tithe, now just think of your produce. Imagine if you had a big farm, a tenth of the wheat. You're not going to carry that from Galilee to Jerusalem, right? So you sell it, and instead you take the money, and you go to the temple, and you buy food with the proceeds, right? But notice it doesn't say anything about taking any of that money from the tithes that you got and actually giving it to the Lord. All he's saying to do is buy food that you like and enjoy it. And actually, this is a little bit risque here. It says strong drink. So here's what I got from this, that you're not to take that money and give it as a sacrifice, but just to eat before the Lord and rejoice with your family. So it seems like eating and rejoicing is commanded to happen even when the sacrificing can't be done. And I found that amazing. And what's amazing about this? Well, I thought the money would have gone, you know, to the temple or to the priests. It was your tithe. Instead, you use it to buy food and feast before the Lord with your family. Why? Because God is a party God. God loves to see us celebrate, right? And that's what this is all about. They went to Jerusalem and they had a party. They had a celebration. Even without giving the money to the Lord, it seems like. Now, maybe back in this verse it says, you spend your money for whatever your soul desires, cattle and sheep. Maybe you were supposed to give those, but it doesn't say that. It says you're to eat this. So that's why I was amazed about this. And then concerning Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles, it's at the end of the harvest. It's the appointed time at the end of the harvest in the fall. And it's appointed time to thank God for the harvest and remember his provision for our ancestors coming out of Egypt when they lived in temporary shelters and tents. But listen to what it says referring to Sukkot here in Deuteronomy 16. 7 days you will feast to Adonai your God in the place he chooses, because Adonai your God will bless you in all your produce and all the work of your hands, and you will be completely filled with joy. This is why Sukkot is called Zman Simchatenu, the time of our rejoicing. So here's my picture, that what God intended for Sukkot was a 7-day feast in Jerusalem. Everybody had to come to Jerusalem. living in temporary dwellings in Jerusalem, all the people to this. This would have been like a giant camp meeting. You see that? They would be going up to the temple to worship. They'd come back and they'd feast. They'd feast with their neighbors because they were just living like in tents right next to each other. They would get to know each other. There would be dancing. There would be singing. It's just amazing how much joy there is there. Yes. Now, this eating together before the Lord springs from another Jewish root, which many of you are familiar with. It's called the Kiddush. And it's a time of sharing bread and wine together after every synagogue service. So I believe they were doing that in Yeshua's time. At the end of the synagogue service, they would have a Kiddush, and they would have the same elements, bread and wine, that he used for the Seder. So you're beginning to see that eating together, feasting, celebrating before the Lord is a significant part of worship in the Old Testament. You see that? And as I meditated on that, I began to see that our God wants us to rejoice and feast, but with him. It's always with him. Before him means he is present when we do this. We do this in his presence. And think of this. What we're doing right now, I mean, we prayed for this before we started, studying his word, we're doing it in his presence, right? When we sang before, wasn't it in his presence? When Mark was leading prayer, wasn't that in his presence? All of these things we do in his presence. When we study the Bible, when we all of these things, they're before him, just like entering into the covenant before him. Okay, another root, rejoicing in this feasting. So in the new covenant, it's a little bit different. Because the new covenant was established at the meal, at the Seder meal, with drinking wine or grape juice and eating matzah, symbolic of the Lord's body and blood, symbolic of eating the sacrifice he was about to make, but it wasn't joyous. I've never seen it portrayed as being joyous when Yeshua gave it, because he was facing the cross. And symbolically, and it was eating the sacrifice, but he was facing the cross. But now it should be with joy because he won the victory and resurrected after being on the cross. And we see evidence of that in the new covenant. In the book of Jude, in chapter 12, he's talking about these times of coming to the Lord's table, and he says, your festive gatherings meant to foster love. Eating together before the Lord was festive, and it fostered love. Love between the people for each other, and love between the people and God. Okay, another Jewish root. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 25. Likewise, also the cup after the meal, saying, this cup is the new covenant effected by my blood. Do this as often as you drink it as a memorial to me. The root here is the phrase, as often as you drink it, as a memorial to me. This is a Jewish root, which is the need to renew the new covenant. And here's the root. Passover and the Sinai covenant are renewed yearly by having what? A meal, a Passover Seder. And according to the Torah, if you don't participate in that, what happens to you? Cut off from the nation of Israel. Sukkot is also about remembering and renewing the Sinai covenant, because it's remembering the wandering in the desert, living in Sukkot, and the Lord providing. So the new covenant also is to be renewed periodically. As often as you drink it as a memorial to me, it must be done periodically. So why? Why did God command these covenants to be renewed? Well, for me, it's pretty simple. God knew, because I know, I'm forgetful. Anybody here else forgetful sometimes? And we would be forgetful of our covenant commitments, of his covenant conditions and promises. He knows we need a periodic reminder to keep us in covenant relationship with him. Just like we need a periodic reminder of the Passover Seder to remember what happened back there. And you know, you have to admit that he knows what he's talking about when he commands these things. because we've been remembering Passover now for 3,500 years. And we haven't forgotten because we keep doing it every year. Okay, back to 1 Corinthians 11. We're going to look at some of the conditions. These are very important. How to keep the Lord's Supper, how to come to the Lord's table. Verse 27, 1 Corinthians 11. Therefore, whoever eats the Lord's bread or drinks the Lord's cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of desecrating the body and the blood of the Lord. Ooh. Verse 28. So let a person examine himself first, and then he may eat of the bread and drink from the cup. Verse 29. For a person who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. Well, pretty heavy warnings there. We are to examine ourselves before we partake in the Lord's Supper and the renewing of the new covenant. So we're going to do this a little bit later, and I hope you all do this every time you come to the Lord's table, is to ask the Holy Spirit, this is the examining, to reveal any unrepentant sin in your life or any offense of any person, anybody you need to apologize to, or anyone you need to forgive, anyone you need to reconcile with, and to repent and forgive and cleanse yourself spiritually in preparation for renewing the new covenant. And that is a root. That is a root from the Tanakh. What is the root? Numbers chapter 9, verse 6. However, there were some men who could not celebrate Passover because of being defiled by a dead body. So ritual cleansing was required before you could keep the Passover. That's why the Pharisees who accused Yeshua would not go into the court of the Gentile, Pontius Pilate, remember that in John? Because they would have to be re-cleansed to eat the Passover. So it was required, and also the days that are coming up now in just about a little more than a month, the 10 days of awe between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur are days for introspection, repentance, and reconciliation with other people and with God. Same thing. And similarly, Rabbi Shaul told us what we must be cleansed from sin to renew the covenant. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 again in verse 30. This is why, and this is really powerful, this is why when you don't cleanse and judge yourself and repent, verse 30, this is why many among you are weak and sick and some have died. Can't be much more strong warning than that. Verse 31, if we would examine ourselves, we would not come under judgment. Verse 32, but when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned along with the world. So those are the consequences. Okay, so we're going to come to the Lord's table here and hopefully in the homes of people watching. So let me start out before we do any giving out or anything. If you have never entered into the new covenant, or if you're not sure you have, whether you're here or you're at home, understand that the other terms that are used for being a partaker of the new covenant are becoming a believer, being born from above, receiving Yeshua as Lord and Savior, giving your heart to the Lord, becoming a child of God, knowing the Lord. They're all expressions for the same thing, becoming part of the kingdom of God. So if you're not sure, or if you've never done this, you can enter in by praying with me right where you are, whether you're here in this room or you're watching on the live stream. So just pray with me now if you want to enter in to the new covenant. Father, I just thank you for revealing yourself to me and giving me a desire to know you. You have commanded me to have no other gods before you, to let nothing be more important to me than you. That's the first commandment. Lord, reveal to me now how I've broken that commandment and others, how I've sinned. I take responsibility for my sin. I'm not going to blame others for it. I'm not going to blame the devil for it. I realize I deserve punishment, judgment for my disobedience. And so I repent and I ask you, Lord, to count Yeshua's sacrificial death, to pay the penalty I owe, And I make you the Lord of my life, and I set my will to obey you. I receive the forgiveness you offer to those who trust in the sacrifice you made and make you Lord. And I ask you, Lord, to give me assurance that I am yours, that I have a place reserved in heaven. I ask you to fill me to the overflowing with your Holy Spirit, your Ruach HaKodesh, and to teach me from your word and lead me by your Spirit all the days of my life. And also connect me with people who can disciple me and lead me in following you. And I ask this in Yeshua's name. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, if you're here, come see me after we're done. If you're online, please send a note to our office. You can find our office's email address on our Facebook page or our website, and it will get to me, and I want to correspond with you no matter where you are, as long as you write in English. I can do that. So at this time, we're going to give out the elements, and we have them in a very COVID-19 socially acceptable form here. They are little packages that contain both the cracker and the juice. So Don's going to get a walk around and give them out, and you can take one. Can I have one, Don? Thank you. And while he's giving them out, I would like you to pray. All of you who are here and all of you who are listening, this can take a few seconds to give it out. Just pray quietly to the Holy Spirit. Just pray with me. Lord, reveal any unrepentant sin to me. Reveal anyone that I need to apologize to. Reveal anyone that I need to forgive. Anyone I need to reconcile with. Cleanse us and make us cleansed to eat your bread and your cup. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, you are very much invited to partake in this as the first act of yours in the kingdom of God. Okay, for those of you who are here, rip off the top, which will expose the little cracker. Be careful you don't rip off the bottom one, that'll open up the drink. This little cracker is not pierced, striped, or bruised, but it looks like it's unleavened. Everybody got it out? Okay, Elizabeth's going to come up here and recite the blessing.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Amen.
Okay, don't eat yet. I want to pray over the cracker. Let me take that. Father, we thank you for offering your sinless body as the atoning sacrifice for our redemption, for our freedom, for our forgiveness. Thank you for suffering the piercing with nails, the striping with a whip, the bruising with fists. We remember that you said to discern your broken body as we eat this matzah, this cracker. I pray, Lord, that you would just help each of us to appreciate the great cost of your sacrifice for us, the suffering. And we thank you for inviting us to eat a meal with you, to meet a meal before you, to eat a meal in your presence. We believe you're here with us now. And because you are a spirit, you are with every person who's watching this live stream right now, which is just amazing the way you are, but you can do that. And I pray, Father, because it's part of what this does. I pray right now for everyone who needs healing. If you need healing, just raise up your hand that doesn't have this in it. Just raise up your hand. I'm looking around. I'm seeing hands go up. Father, your word says that there is healing in the Lord's Supper. And I pray, Father, for that to manifest for whatever is the problem, whatever needs healing in those whose hands are raised up. And we just thank you, Lord, that you invite us to meet this meal together before you, because we are your family. We are family. We are mishpacha, even those of you who are out there watching. And we rejoice because we are family. Can you all rejoice and say thank you? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for your covenant. Thank you for your joy. Thank you that you love us so much. Thank you that you made these ways for us to be in your presence and be before you. Thank you, Lord. Take and eat the body of Messiah broken for you. Well, it sure doesn't taste like a matzah. So now, for your second dexterous challenge, is to remove the second seal on the cup to expose the juice. Okay, hold up the juice, and Elizabeth's going to recite the blessing. You can recite it with her.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pari hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Amen.
So, Father, we thank you for pouring out your blood to ratify the new covenant. But we also believe, Lord, that you sanctify us. So we just thank you for setting us apart to God. You deliver us, and we pray for deliverance from any bondage we have to sin or to Satan or to any of his forces. And we thank you for redeeming us by paying the penalty for our sin. We declare that Satan and sin have no legal authority over us, because you have removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. He has no authority. He cannot claim us back. Thank you for making us your people and being our God and leading us. We pray that you would lead us to know you more intimately, better, closer each day. And Father, we thank you that you know our human frailty, our forgetfulness, our easily distractedness. And so you tell us to renew this covenant periodically. So we renew it now. We renew our covenant commitment to seek your face, to obey your commands, to love one another, to abide in the vine, to be in unity. And we thank you, Father, for your blood poured out for us. Take and drink. This is the blood of the covenant. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, Complete Children's Program Interpretation for the Deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.